Hello and welcome to this week's edition of the Podcast Posse podcast. This week we're going to be discussing vaccines and where we go from here. This week we have a little bit of a different panel. We have an additional guest with us, but let's introduce everyone starting with this side.
I'm Jade.
I'm Brianna.
I'm Dan as usual.
I'm Katie.
I'm Noah.
All right, so now that we know some of the panelists, Katie's here to join us this week. She's been discussing vaccines in some of her classes recently, so we thought that she would be a great addition to this week's discussion.
Okay, so, insider help.
I mean, we're just punting to you now. Katie, tell us everything we want to know.
Well, vaccinate, first of all.
Oh, oh. Well, now that we know where she stands, bias. Okay. For real, though. let's discuss some of the things that are happening in the news. So I don't know if you guys heard, but now Arizona is actually legislating some changes to their current vaccination laws where they're actually loosing restrictions for children so that they can get more exemptions with vaccines. So my question to you guys is, how do you feel about this? And do you think that there will be some repercussions?
I've read a little bit on it, and part of what I was reading is that they want to have testing before children are vaccinated to make sure that vaccines are safe for them. And I do think that is important to diminish the amount of vaccine injuries we are seeing in children. And I think it's a good start to say, know how a child's gonna react, because there are people who do have allergic reactions. There are injuries that happen because of vaccines, and I think it's a positive legislature to add to Arizona to allow people to be safer from vaccines.
Yeah, I did see that too, and I thought that that was probably the most level-headed addition to the law in that case, but that is actually one of only three laws that they're adding there, and one of the other big ones was a religious exemption for a lot of people, as well as it's like it's you're not given, or I guess I should turn that around. They're adding additional requirements for doctors to give additional information regarding certain vaccinations, meaning the addition of or the incidence of certain adverse effects in the community, things like that. So yeah, there's, it's kind of a mixed bag. But yeah, I mean, does anyone want to address any other parts of that?
I don't know. One of the articles that we all read was mentioning California,
right,
and what, you know, laws we passed after we had our outbreak here in what, 2014. So
yeah, that was a big one.
Yeah. So I think that's great, and I think that that's a good idea, because there are people who do get harmed by vaccines for, you know, whatever reason, they're allergic to them. But California said, okay, now you have to get vaccinated. You don't get exemptions for the mandatory vaccines because people are abusing them, right? Especially when you're talking about religious ones. It's very easy to say, my religion says I can't do this because of this, this, and this. So I think
get out jail free card.
In American society, it is in kind of a way.
So, mean,
not that there's not good reasons sometimes, but you're right.
So no, I think that is where they should have gone. Clearly, that wasn't the intention of these laws, though. It wasn't to make it harder for people to get exemptions. It was to make it easier for people to go. I don't think my kid can have a vaccine. But I think that that what California did in conjunction with maybe having the testing beforehand would have been a far smarter thing to do. So that way, you know, right? You can say, my kid's gonna get harmed, so maybe I don't, or my kid will be fine, so give them the vaccine.
So you know where you stand, and you know that you can safely pursue it.
Exactly, and that's a smart thing. And maybe even that makes it easier for parents to make that decision. When a doctor says, your kid's been tested, they'll be safe.
They're good, yeah.
Yeah.
Green light.
You've been green lit?
Yep.
Yeah, I mean, there's. I don't think there's anything wrong with more information in any of these contexts. Yeah, if it is legitimately being given as a way for people to make a more informed decision about, you know, what sort of drugs they should be taking or what sort of vaccines they should be receiving, then yeah, ultimately I do think that's a good thing. However, it should not be, in my opinion, an opportunity for science or research that hasn't been backed up by years of research and years of study to creep into these discussions, because we have seen what one study made by one guy.
Who admitted that he doctored his results.
Yeah, absolutely. He's thrown an entire wrench into everything. I mean, like you said, you were talking about Puerto Rico earlier and the fact that one person introduced back into the country has now created a wildfire there. And then back in 2000, the United States declared that measles was done, that it was never going to pop up again. And then now since then, everything's been going through. Yeah, that's the sound it makes when it happens.
That's measles.
That's measles coming for you.
Here it comes.
Right. Yep, it's coming.
Yeah, so I mean, I think you're right. It's, you know, more informed decisions probably going to be better in that case, no matter what. But why do you think it is that Arizona went the opposite direction than California?
I want to say...
Good question, Dan.
Yeah. Wow, Dan. I don't know.
Well, yeah, I don't know, man. Like, let's...
That's
like,
a good... Well, why do... Why does
it out here, man?
Yeah, you were talking about the one study, right? And you can have people who were alive then who read that and they go... Yeah. They point to that as their reason why. But you have younger people now, right? People in their 20s who are also making that decision that they go, I'm not going to vaccinate my kid. Why?
Sure.
Why did you make that? What made you go, I'm not going
to
vaccinate
my kid? I need to understand that mindset where they're like, my kid doesn't need to be vaccinated. Mm-hmm. Like, why... Why do you think, like, they're like, my kid's strong. Like, my kid's got this. Like, we're not on that same page on that.
That is one of the arguments.
Yeah, exactly.
Literally.
That's what I'm saying.
That,
I feel like there's a lot of reasons, and that's part of the problem, is you're trying to solve a problem that a lot of people have different reasons for, you know, not vaccinating their kids. So it's like, how do you satisfy the people who are saying, I don't want my kid to get autism, if you're also trying to satisfy the people that say, my kid will get through it, you know, my kid's stronger, I'm vegan, so I don't want to vaccinate my kid, or whatever it is. There's a lot of reasons that people have, and some of them are legitimate and most of them are not, but how then do you solve that problem? I don't know. So to the Arizona thing, I don't know. It could be a bunch of different reasons. It could just be that the people there who are in their legislature are people who have their reasons.
Maybe.
And they were like, let's make it easier. I don't know.
Yeah.
Well, to bring up the autism part is that autism is seen to be pretty heretic, and it can be very, very based on who your parents are.
Yeah.
And if we look at history where we didn't see as much autism, one, it wasn't being diagnosed in the same way it is now. There isn't there weren't the early intervention steps that we have and take today. And then also we see that you can ask your grandparents, and they will always tell you that there was that one person in their class that was really smart, but just different from everyone else. And they could have had autism. We just don't know that. And then they later ended up getting married and having kids and maybe passing it on to them. Whereas, say, 200 years ago, if you were smart like that, you didn't normally get married. You didn't normally have kids. You went and studied and you wrote books and you worked in, you worked as a monk or something like that. You worked in certain places where you wouldn't have children. You wouldn't pass on these genes.
It's a lot of isolation.
Exactly. And so saying that vaccines cause autism is not focusing on the fact that autism's been around far before vaccines were. And so
hit him with that.
You can't. And then it's also the fact that it's like, are you that fearful and hateful towards people with autism that you would rather have your kid possibly get sick than to live a life that is different from yours?
Yeah, I know. I do think that that is injected in the conversation too. It's like, I get it. It's like you don't want your kid to be quote unquote different in that case, but the risk right now, it's just, it's not, it's not apparent.
It's messed up for real. Like they're like, yeah, I'll take measles over autism any day. It's like, no, we should probably flip flop those ones.
Right.
Like, that's like, especially when it's like if I'm a parent and then my kid's like going to school, and I know that, like, these other kids or whatever, like, there's other parents who are like, oh, I'm not getting my kid vaccinated. Like, if I'm the parent, I'm like, I would really appreciate it if you got your kid vaccinated, because we're kind of sharing the same classroom. And, like we've already, like, kind of discussed this. Like, kids are gross, man. Like, they're, like, they got snot running on their face. Like, they cough with their mouth open all the time. Yeah. Like, they're going all over the place, like, just, like, spreading germs left and right. And, like, one kid's going to be, like, messing it up for everyone because he didn't get vaccinated. Like, couldn't be me, man. Like, that's, I gotta be like, no, my kid's vaccinated. Like, if it's happening, it's like some other person's kid. It's like, I don't know, man. That's just,
it messes up herd immunity.
Exactly.
And that's the goal.
Yeah. And you can bring up the fact that vaccines are only like a certain percentage effective, But if everybody's vaccinated, you're gonna, it's that herd immunity, you're gonna lessen how many people can get it.
Exactly.
Because say three of us get vaccinated, one of us doesn't, and then one of us gets a vaccine that isn't completely solid, that doesn't protect them, and that one person can then infect that other person who got a vaccine, mm-hmm. but it just didn't work right with their body, so they then get sick, and then they can pass it on to other people who didn't get vaccinated. And most of the time, the people who don't get vaccinated have medical exemptions because they don't have a proper immune system mm-hmm. to be vaccinated.
That's right. Yeah, so it's, I mean, that is the main argument that I'm seeing from at least the California legislature side mm-hmm. is that it's, they're trying to protect those who can't receive the vaccine in the first place.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Because they're providing the service for them, namely public school. Mm-hmm. It's like our tax scholars are going to provide this service, exactly. so you need to protect the people who really can't protect themselves.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And if you're making the choice to not protect yourself or making the choice to actively put at risk the life and health of someone else, then there's a discussion of like,
yeah, and that's like someone else's child too.
Right.
So that's like, and like the, like, I guess like protective factor in terms of parents is like maximum, right? Like, that's my kid. I don't want anything to happen to like my kid. So it's like vaccinate your kid. Cause if they're putting my kid at risk, then like we're already enemies at that point.
We have a problem.
We have a problem. It's like,
enemies.
And like other blood things too enemies. That I've seen where it's like the examples of if my kid can't bring peanut butter to school mm-hmm. because maybe another kid's allergic to peanut butter, then it's like your kid shouldn't be able to come if he's not vaccinated.
Your kid can't bring measles if mine.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, exactly.
Well,
Your kid's got to stay home with his polio, right?
Yeah.
Same thing.
Right? Yeah.
I think also too, like some people may not vaccinate their children because maybe for their experience that they're afraid of needles, and maybe they don't want their children to experience that. Even though I feel like that's kind of silly though, because you can outgrow that. But some people just like, oh, I want to protect my. Some people are over. Some parents are overbearing. They're very overly exactly. protective, and they feel like, oh, if they get vaccinated, that's going to be a problem when it's not really a problem.
It's not, and you're right. I think this probably is a minority of that community, but it's true. I'm sure there are some people that even, we're going back to religious exemptions mm-hmm. too, like they're not just denying vaccinations. They're going against everything.
Yeah.
They're
yeah.
like, no, we're not doing any medical care at all. This goes against, you know, everything I believe, et cetera, et cetera. So yeah, I think there definitely is that element to that too.
I know
for
we
sure.
talked too that people just don't grasp the situation of some of these diseases because mm-hmm. they've never seen them.
Right.
They didn't live mm-hmm. through times where, you know, they were rampant among people, you know, with like polio and measles, things that were debilitating not that long ago. Mm-hmm. We don't see that now. So you don't understand this. You don't grasp the gravity of having those things happen, the outbreaks, and the amount of people that they can affect in such a short amount of time.
Mm-hmm. There's an example of that actually in Japan in the 70s when pertussis was big. People started vaccinating their kids, and for about 5 years, vaccines always happened for pertussis, and which is whooping cough, mm-hmm. and they didn't have any outbreaks. And then 5 years later, it wasn't happening. People weren't getting whooping cough because they were vaccinated. So people were like, oh, I don't want to give them these chemicals if they don't need it. And they stopped and they laid off, and then outbreaks started happening again because they weren't vaccinating. And it's that rhythm of repetition where, mm-hmm. oh, I don't want to vaccinate because it doesn't actually happen, so why would I do this for them? But it's like, it doesn't happen because you're vaccinating.
Yeah.
So
it's the weird logic where you jump over the fact that the vaccine was the reason why it wasn't happening.
I don't get it, man. I don't get it.
It happens every day on a micro level, especially with pharmacology, with meds. Mm-hmm. Happens every single day that someone starts taking a new med, they feel better, whatever the thing might be, and then they go, oh, this has made me feel better, now I can get off the med, I don't need to take it anymore. Mm-hmm. And then what happens? It comes back.
It's like, it's almost like it was working. Like, come on, it's doing its job. Like, what?
With antibiotics, you have to keep taking them. You have to finish your entire prescription, and people aren't, because they're like, oh, I've been taking this one for strep throat for a week out of 10 days and mm-hmm. I feel fine, so I'm not going to take these last 3 days of medication. But that means that you are not immune to that that strain of strep, and you can get it again, and you can't get antibiotics for it. It's not going to work because you didn't finish it that first time.
Mm-hmm. That's how we get superbugs.
Mm-hmm.
That's why every successive new round of different bacteria that we're getting infected with are becoming stronger and stronger and stronger because people are not finishing their regimen of antibiotics. They're not killing everything. So if they don't kill everything and it escapes, it's basically survival of the fittest at a microbiological level.
Yeah.
And then that just propagates down the line. Mm-hmm. And it's just, Yeah, that's going to be another episode. That's gonna, we're going to go on from there. But yeah, I think we have a good little roundup right now of what's currently going on. So when we come back, we're going to be talking about the future of vaccines and what we can do about solving some of the issues related to them. Stay tuned.
If you have an interest in a career in sports broadcasting,
whether it's behind the scenes or on camera,
then this is the class for you.
Class is held every Wednesday from 1:30 to 4:30 in room 121 alongside the library building.
For more information, contact Greg Poff. That's me at solano.edu.
We hope to see you here next semester. And remember,
it's more than just sports. It's an education.
Hello and welcome back to the Podcast Posse podcast. This is our second segment dealing with vaccines and where we go from here. So, Jade, your mom's on Pinterest, right?
Yeah.
So, what does she do on Pinterest, do you know?
You know, she looks up a lot of weird stuff to do in my room and my bathroom and then asks me about whether or not I want to do this in my room or bathroom. Yeah. And the answer is always, I don't care, I'm moving out soon.
Has she found any recent pages on anti-vaccination?
You know what? Not that she's told me. Just because I don't think she's looking for it, but I'm sure they're out there. And maybe like a post gets like lost in the middle of something else she's looking at. But no, she hasn't mentioned it to me.
Yeah, I mean, right now, I wouldn't be surprised if that would be the case, that most people probably wouldn't find it anymore, because in the news, I don't know if you guys heard about this, recently Pinterest started cracking down on anti-vaccination material that was being spread throughout Pinterest, because as we know...
What's that?
Good for Pinterest.
Good for Pinterest. Yeah. Well, yeah, I mean, they saw the writing on the wall. Pinterest is definitely a social media that caters towards mothers.
Yes.
A lot. Yeah. As my mom's on Pinterest. You said your mom's on Pinterest. Yep. Your mom's on Pinterest.
My mom, yeah.
Yep. I mean, and who's making decisions about vaccinations?
Moms.
Moms.
100%. We talked about this.
Yeah, yes. That it's usually
it's
moms.
It's literally like, I've never heard a single dad out there being like, you vaccinate your kids? Never. It's
no.
It's always the mom. All the time.
Always. Yeah. I mean, that's usually right after birth and through the younger years of child rearing, that is when you would bring your children to go get vaccinated, right? Even starting hepatitis B is like right at birth.
Yep.
It's like, so birth all the way through, you know, even stuff at 16 years old that you can go through if you're doing HPV, something like that. So throughout those years, it usually for most families, it's the mother who's the primary caretaker. So yeah, that's definitely going to lead to some of that material being spread through a market that's exclusively on one piece of social media.
Mm-hmm.
But what do you think about that? Do you think it's right that they... that?
I think it's smart. Yeah. I think they don't want to have to deal with... I mean, because even then, what? Oh my gosh, who was it? Was it Schiff who sent a letter to Facebook asking them how they were going to restrict anti-vax things? They're trying to stop it before it gets too big. I think don't want to get in trouble. I think they're like... You know what? This could come back to bite us in the butt right now.
Yeah.
People are probably complaining about it a little bit. And anti-vaxxers, and we've talked about this before on a multitude of subjects, there's always a very loud minority.
Sure.
And anti-vaxxers are a minority.
Yes.
Sure.
If a majority of your users are not anti-vaxxers and that's just all that's popping up on their feed sometimes, they're going to go, okay, get this out
cut
of here.
It.
I don't want it. So I think this is just them going, we understand there's a lot of it. And we don't want to deal with it either way, so we're just going to take it all off.
Yeah. Sure.
No, and I think if we're thinking, like, long-term, you know, like, where we're going, like, in the future, like, we all know, like, social media, huge for literally any subject.
Oh,
it's huge, no matter what it is. And, like, you know, not being vaccinated and that kind of thing, that's, like, a really prevalent thing when it comes to, like, especially social media, because you can voice your opinion on whatever you want. And so if, like, all of these factors are going on, I think it's, like, a good step to be, like, let's just take that down right now. To be like, we can clear that out because we don't want anything coming back on like Pinterest or whatever. If they're like, oh, like, how come you don't vaccinate your kids? And like, well, I saw a thing on Pinterest. And they're like, great, well, Pinterest is why the whole, like, all these kids are dead now. So yeah. It's like, yeah, that's not, yeah. Thanks, Pinterest.
You went right for the nose there.
Yeah. I was going to say, there's a difference between like opinion and fact. And I feel like when they're talking about vaccination, they're just talking about their opinion. There's no factual behind it all. So it's kind of like, I see why Pinterest is like, okay, we can't be doing this because I don't mind freedom of speech or freedom of opinion, but this is not good.
And it's not their demographic.
Yeah, it's not promoting something that's good for anybody. At all.
So I'm saying, I don't think they want to be the focal point of that.
Yeah.
Like right. When it comes back on them. You never want to be like the beginning of something really bad.
No, exactly.
Yeah. Like, all these anti-vaxxers met up on Pinterest.
Exactly.
Yeah. Now it's spreading, and you're like, wait. Yeah.
Pinterest.
Yeah. And they're like, I just want to tell you how to make marshmallow snowman or whatever,
exactly,
you know?
Yeah. We just want like Thanksgiving decorations.
How to decorate your table.
Exactly.
It is the Martha Stewart of social media.
Yeah.
So Martha doesn't want to be responsible for.
Exactly.
Yeah. No,
she's already
Martha,
gone to jail.
Yeah, but Martha's like,
yeah. Yeah, that was my favorite intro ever. Was the fact that Snoop Dogg and Martha was like, one of us has been to federal prison.
I love their friendship.
That was the best. Oh my gosh. But anyway, that was getting off topic. But yeah, I mean, I agree with you. But ultimately, Pinterest is a private company, and I would argue there's less of a conflict because I would say some people will bring up the fact that by restricting certain content on social media sites like this, you're effectively cutting off an ideas marketplace for a section of the community, right? You're cutting off a place that's essential for today's communication. Like, there's no denying that everyone is on social media, everyone wants to be a part of it, everyone wants to share ideas on it. So that big argument is always like, well, if you kick people off of Facebook or if you kick certain groups off of this or that, that you're totally removing them from the marketplace of ideas, and we can't really bring them out into the light, you know? Mm. So do you think that that would have negative consequences ultimately if now all of these people are suddenly pushed to the side, or do you think it's better to stop the spread? Not unlike what a vaccine would do.
Stop the spread.
Look at that.
Yeah. Hey. Yeah, didn't.
Negative in what way? Like.
Okay, because the idea is that if you, the idea to furthering knowledge is to bringing things out into the light.
Okay.
Like, if you can bring a bad idea out in the open, it will be discredited as a bad idea. So now if you've cut off certain ideas from a marketplace where they're out in the open, it's like they're going to be pushed back into the darker, more less apparent areas of the web, which then, do you think that that would allow it to fester, or do you think it's a better idea that it's cut off from other people joining in?
That it's cut off.
I was going to say, like,
don't make it more accessible.
Yeah, because I was going to say, even if they put it out there, even if you try to correct them, they're not going to listen anyway. They're going to think that, oh, you're full of crap. Okay,
exactly,
I'm just do me and do whatever I want to do. So it's like,
that's
saying.
Wow, it's uncanny. Are you anti-vaccination?
No. Without that, I would have died. I was a sick child a lot. My sister and I were very sick a lot, so it's kind of a good thing we did vaccination, because
You guys got it all throughout.
Yeah, because we're preemie, so it's kind of like we need it.
Yeah.
So I don't understand why people don't think that way. Like, do you want your kids to not live?
Because they don't have to.
Or to have polio?
Yeah,
they just don't understand.
I don't know. I see like both sides of it, where it's like push them off into like their own little thing and let them have their own little we don't vaccinate our kids party over here. And it's like, but also like we could like probably like bring that to light just so like more people can see like how dumb that is. Like, we have to like put it out there and be like, this shouldn't even be a conversation where it's like, do you vaccinate your kids? It should be like, yes. Like, no matter what, I want them to be like protected, even if it could lead to autism, it could lead to this. At the end of the day, they're protected. The people around them are protected because they have they're vaccinated. It shouldn't be like I don't know. That's why I'm in the middle. It could be like, leave them over there, let them like do their own thing. But also, it's like, we need to like see that these people exist to be like, you guys are wrong. This is like, we should probably get on the same page about this instead of just letting them like fester and like just continue to let their kids not live past five.
I think we also need to look at doctors and make sure that they are properly consulting with the mothers of these babies, because it's mostly mothers, but with the parents, and saying, this is why we vaccinate, and talking to them with compassion towards their fears, and not just saying, well, we do this, so you're doing it. But educating them and understanding them and taking their time with a patient, not saying, well, we only have 10 minutes today because this is all we have for your baby's two-month wellness check.
Yeah,
it should be, we're going to talk to you, we're going to educate you, we're going to address your fears, we're going to make sure you have all of the information. Mm-hmm. And that is one of Arizona's laws, where the new possible laws that they say the doctors have to list the risks. Mm-hmm. And we also then, people are saying, well, there's all these risks, why are we doing it? Mm-hmm. But it's also, why do people get surgery? Why do people get elective surgery at that?
Mm-hmm. Or take medication, because there's so many, like...
Yeah, like, every single commercial you watch, it's like, they're having a blast, they're, like, old with a dog, I don't know, they're all weird, but, like...
Hanging out in bathtubs, exactly, holding hands.
But no matter what, you got that list that just goes, mm-hmm. where it's like, bad, 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 you definitely don't want this, bad, 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 mm-hmm. it's like, death. And then it's like, it's always on there, but it's like... go ahead and take it. It's like, you always have to like say the risk, which is like, we're accustomed to seeing that. So I feel like if it's like even like face to face, it's like, this exists, but like, this is what you need.
Yeah.
You know? Mm-hmm. So it's like.
No, I think you're totally right about that. Coming at it, when you're the doctor, especially, and you're talking to the parents, I think it's easy to make fun of somebody online. You don't know them. It's whatever.
No, yeah, exactly.
But yeah, when you're talking to your doctor, again, I think people sincerely, I think some people just don't understand how they work. And so you have to take the time to explain to somebody who doesn't understand, especially if you're talking to a parent who's on the fence.
Yeah.
Maybe they've heard things here, but they're not really sure. Those are definitely parents where you take your time and you talk to them and you make sure that they understand everything. Even if it is the risks, I get the argument that then that, you know, invites more people to, you know, go, I'm not going to vaccinate my kid. But tell them, let them know it's a possibility, but also say, but here's all of the great things that could also happen for your child. Here's all the other great things that it does for the society as a whole, you know?
Absolutely.
Learn what their concerns are.
I read a woman's story on her blog, probably posted to Pinterest, but she said that she had her baby, it was the 2-month wellness check, and she was terrified going in because she knew that's when a lot of the vaccines are started, and she was anxious and she just couldn't like fathom giving, because everything she's been hearing about how bad vaccines are, and she's on these mommy web pages of like, here's how to properly burp your baby, but there's also those articles of don't vaccinate your kids, and so she was terrified, and she went in and her doctor did take the time and sat with her and made sure she knew what was happening, and she walked out of there with her baby being vaccinated because she was educated. She knew. She had all of the information.
Yeah,
that's right.
She wasn't just going with the flow. She was smart, and she made sure that she was ready for it. And she made sure that what she was doing was the best for her kid, and it was vaccines.
Yeah. No, I agree. I think that's important to make sure that everyone has the right amount of info going in, especially at a time when it's like 2 months is a very young baby, and say, and things have gone wrong with babies even older than that, so getting as much information as possible is good. But I want to run off this vein too real quick, because what you brought up about getting all the information, I think, hits the nail on the head. A lot of the anti-vaccination movement has been really good with getting their core messages out there. They've been really good at going out on Pinterest and Facebook and all these other things and sending out their message to as many people as possible. How do you think the pro-vaccination side can do a better job of getting out that information than what they're already doing? I think one thing that you said already was doctors, for sure, but what do you think the other side can do about getting out the word that there is a lot of good benefits for this?
See, okay, I think like the thing like about that is like the people who are like, we're like pro, you know, in fact, like get your kid vaccinated.
Sure.
I feel like we are like pretty aggressive when it comes to that, because you hear like, oh, I don't vaccinate my kid, and it's like, you're terrible.
Or
it's
sure, like, you know, like, judgment has passed.
It's
judgment has
like,
passed really
so
quick.
So maybe like, we gotta tone it down a little bit, which I mean like, that's like, I don't know, I guess like me saying that is bad because I'm not gonna tone it down. It's like, no, you need to get your kid vaccinated. But I feel like if like moving forward, if we're trying to be like, to feel out the room and be like, no, this is like okay, this is what we need, like, you know, just to like, it's like, when you think about like, it's for the kids, like, you know, we want them to grow up big and strong, all that kind of stuff, being on like the same playing field, I guess, instead of just being like us versus them.
Sure. That's I think that's a good way to go too. Yeah.
I don't know. I think it's hard to be the majority in any of those situations. Again, the minority is almost always the loudest people. There's always going to be more mean comments than there is nice comments.
Yeah.
Because most people go on with their day and they don't feel the need to sit there and type about something
if
they don't have negative feelings about it. So I think you could have a, you know, coordinated social media effort, but that is harder to do with more people and making sure that the right information is still out there. Because even, I mean, pro-vaccine people say stuff sometimes and it's not true and it's, you know, out of the side of their neck.
Yeah, definitely.
And you have to make sure that everybody's saying the right thing. But I think social media is a great place to start. And I think Noah said too, maybe the tone of the message has to change a little bit too. You know, people are not inclined to listen to people who are yelling at them.
Yeah,
just ingrained in us, you know?
That's very true.
But I don't know. I think it's just harder to be the majority in those situations. It's harder to coordinate and get the information out there. I think making sure, again, even pro-vaccine people, they need to know where the right information is. Because I think it's easy to say, I'm pro-vaccine, vaccinate your kid. But then, you know, you don't have anything to point to tell them where to go. Mm-hmm. You know, there's government websites that will give you that information.
CDC.
Yeah, but people
FDA.
Don't know that sometimes. So make sure the people who are pro-vaccine, who are trying to get the information out there about vaccines, know where to send people to get that information, I think is one big thing. Because I think even a lot of people don't know where to get that information.
Exactly. Yeah. I agree with you. I think it's what you just said about coordinated social media. It's a good way to go. Mm-hmm. I think the CDC would do well to try and create some of that in their social media presence, whether it be through Twitter or whatever. And I get the CDC doesn't attract a lot of followers on their pages. I get it. I'm not really like looking for the latest update on whatever disease is spreading through South Georgia at this particular time. But, I mean, yeah, you get the point. It's there's been a lot of very loud celebrities that have gotten the spotlight because they are in the minority. Mm-hmm. And so combating that is getting spokespeople that are willing to step up and say, like, hey, I had this experience. You know, I was young. I was very sick at a certain age. And vaccines did X, Y, and Z for me. Or, you know, vaccines have helped us climb out of this. I feel like it's going to take more than just the government saying, vaccine good, then, you know, to get this out, right? It's like, okay.
Maybe personal testimony is important.
Yeah, totally. Finding people who either got vaccinated and still stand with vaccines, or also people who did get injured from vaccines and then, but still standing with them saying, yes, this happened to me, but I'm such a, this doesn't happen often enough for it to be a big issue. Yeah, I'm still alive, I'm still kicking, so. Mm-hmm. And making the most of it. So why are you gonna deny your kid this when they can still live a full and happy life? Because then it's saying, oh, these people who are vaccine injured can't live happy lives. These people with chronic illnesses cannot be successful when they can be. Mm-hmm. And that is just allowing people to be happy and understanding that health is important. But you don't have to have 100% health to be healthy.
Yeah.
Right. I agree. Yeah, I think it's been pretty productive discussion. Yeah, hopefully we can see some of these, a lot of these initiatives come out into light. Hopefully we can see, you know, more information get put out, no matter what it is, whether it is testimonies from people who have been injured, you know, by them in the past, people who have, you know, been helped by them in the past, and then getting those concerns of people who really are scared of what the outcome might be should they vaccinate their child, getting all that out there, I think, no matter what, is going to help, because everything that comes into the light eventually, if it's discussed enough, hopefully it pushes society in the right direction, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, vaccinate your kids.
Talk to your doctor. All right, well, thank you everyone for joining us in this week's edition of the Podcast Posse Podcast. My name is Dan.
I'm Jade.
Brianna.
Katie.
I'm Noah.
Sweet. We'll see you next week.